Good morning, viewers. A very happy Independence Day to each one of you. So, like all Saturdays, we take you through one or the other aspect of human behavior. And if you notice, in the last two Saturdays, we were, trying to look within, and Dr. Ali was taking us through a journey within ourselves. So if you remember, the topic before this was falling in love again, or happiness is a journey. So this is all about self and topics related to that. So today is Independence Day, and what does independence or freedom mean to you? So Dr. Ali will take us into this journey, and please feel free to write your comments and your questions. So today's topic is creating inner freedom. So over to Dr. Alina.
Thank you, Seema. Very, very good morning and a very happy Independence Day to all of you. Such a pleasure to be talking to you on this day when our country has completed 73 years of independence. Most of us were not born. I have a few friends who were born before that, and it's lovely sometimes to hear their stories and things like that, how that process took place. Anyway, it was a long struggle, as those of you who actually were interested in history and who found out, there was a very, very long and very, difficult struggle, at the end of which, on 15th August 1947, India as a country became independent. Now, today, what I want to make us feel aware of and work on is a very simple factor, that is the difference between independence and freedom, and then how freedom has to come from within, and that's the reason why I'm using the word inner freedom. Okay, now independence, as you know, is the opposite of dependence. At some point you are dependent on somebody. If a conqueror comes in, the British come and establish their rules, we have to be dependent on them because they control our lives. They are the government, they are the authority. And they say that you have to be dependent on us, and we will determine how your life is going to be, what the laws and regulations will be, how the money will be dealt with, so many things. So the day we say that, okay, thank you very much, it's been nice having you, please go back to your own country and we'd like to run our own country, we move from dependence to independence, right? At a very personal level, more or less the same thing happens. You have a small child who is dependent on his parents, his teachers, whoever they are. For a long time in his life, he is dependent. And then what happens? Slowly he starts moving towards independence. Where the parent used to hold his hand and drop him to school, now they say, okay, you are old enough now, you can go in the van or bus or whatever it is. When the child grows a little more independent, parents say, okay, now you can go out and play by yourself in the evenings or holidays and stuff like that. Then they say you can even travel now without your parents. So that's how the whole thing goes. And the child starts becoming more and more independent. That is what we define as independence at the level of the country, at the level of the individual self. So independence comes from outside. The person on whom we were dependent, the country, the parent, whoever it may be, when that person lets go, if that person doesn't let go, then you don't have independence. So you may hear a fairly grown-up child saying that, no, my parents are very strict, they don't allow me to go out, or they don't allow me to do this, I'm still dependent on their permission, their authority, and things of that sort. So the dependence and the independence is controlled by an external source, right? Only when that external source allows you to move on, then you start becoming independent. Then what happens? You have the independence, but do you have the freedom is my basic question, which I want you to please mull over and think today. What does it mean to have the freedom of what to do? You know, when I am addressing students who need to take a career choice, there are a lot of young students who are at loggerheads with their parents, and they say that I want to choose my career, it's my life, I'll decide what I want to do. And parents very often get a little upset and they say, you're too young to know what to do, we will tell you what to do, and the child says no. So here is this battle of, you know, dependence, independence, freedom, not freedom, and all these things. Whenever I'm addressing such a group or such students, I tell them a small little story. I tell them that, you know, here was this guy who was finishing his studies and this and that. Maybe he came to 12th standard and he was completing his 12th standard, and it was his 18th birthday. The week after that, he told all his friends, on Sunday, I want you guys to come to my house. I'm going to give a big party and I'm going to give you a big surprise. They said, what surprise? They said, no, I'm not going to tell you. It's going to be a real amazing surprise. Okay, be sure that you are at my house on Sunday at some such time. Very curious, all his friends, they landed up there. And as they entered his house, they saw standing right in front of his door a brand new gleaming motorbike. And this guy comes out from inside and shows it to his friends and says, see, this is my bike. Hey, congrats, man. You're the first in our group to get a bike. Yeah. Then he says, you know, it's my bike. See these registration papers registered in my name. My bike. Lifetime tax paid. My bike. Insurance paid. My bike. And you know something? I paid 3,000 bucks extra for this metallic red color. My bike. His friends are getting more and more and more impressed with him. And he says, this bike, you know what its capacity is? Engine capacity is so much, mileage is so much, this is that is that, all that, my bike. Then he sheepishly turns to them and says, I don't know how to ride a bike. But that is the difference between independence and freedom. I have got independence to run my life, but do I have the freedom to run my life? Do I know how to run my life? That has to come from within. Now you may say, it's one and the same. When you have independence, you can do whatever you want, isn't it? No. If I get independence, as you know, along with India in that era, 60, 70 years back, so many countries in Asia, Africa, everywhere, they got independence, the same as us. But within a few years, what happened? They did not use that independence properly. They did not develop their country into a truly independent country. So what happened? Some dictators, some external people, some internal people, somebody came and took control. And these guys, they became slaves all over again. They had no freedom to do whatever they wanted. So just by getting independence, it does not mean that a country or an individual can be free to do what he wants. To be able to be free, you have to exercise choices. You have to make up your mind and build up that inner strength, which says that I am now going to be free and I am going to take my own decisions. Very often, we talk about our ability to have control over others. And if I'm a boss in the office, I dictate terms to others. I tell my subordinates, I'm the boss. I'm going to tell you what you have to do and you jolly well have to do it. Got it? Yes, boss, you're paying us salary. We are not independent, so we will listen to you. But does this person have the freedom to take the right choices? Is he running his office only to please his super boss, who is another nasty character sitting somewhere? So is he trying to control himself? Is he restricting himself only to make sure that he gets a good rating and his boss is happy with him. Is that freedom? No. He's independent. He has been given an independent charge of that office or of that department. But is he free to do what he wants? No. If he can come, bring himself to the stage where he says, if you want to give me independence, then you also have to give me the freedom to choose. If I believe that this is the right step for me and my team, I will do it. And I'll pay the price for it. I am responsible. I am willing to hold the buck and not pass the buck. Give me a chance and I'll work on this thing and I'll give you results. That is the difference between independence and freedom. If you look inwards, I would even ask you a very, very simple question. Do you have the freedom to control your own emotions? Emotions come from within. You don't know when you're going to be happy, what's going to make you sad, what's going to irritate you, what's going to make you jealous or angry or whatever it is. It comes from within, right? At that moment, you have no control over it. It's purely a feeling, an emotion. But when you are experiencing that emotion, do you have the freedom to choose and say, this is how I am going to manage my emotion? Management of emotion, the second and one of the most important pillars of emotional intelligence. I am getting very angry with what the other person is doing. But am I only reacting to him? Or am I thinking over and responding to him? If I am only reacting, then I don't have freedom. I am bound by my own emotions and lack of my control over my emotions. I can't do anything beyond that. But if I have control over my anger, and if I say, yes, right now I am very angry, but this is how I am going to manage my anger. And that does not mean suppressing anger also, remember that. It only means managing my anger. I have the freedom to take whatever decision I want. Is there a need for me to raise my voice and shout at that person? Or is it far better to maintain my dignity and remain quiet? Should I take disciplinary action and face whatever consequences will come out of that? Do I have the ability to evaluate and say that disciplinary action will make these guys perform better, or will they perform worse because they will become bitter and angry with me? And the same thing applies wherever we are talking about. It's not just restricted to work. That is the way you deal with your own closest of relationships. Do you have that freedom? Have you built up that skill, that ability, and that courage, I would say, to say that, yes, I am willing to risk this, but I am going to be taking decisions which are based on my own freedom. Those of you who are avid readers may have read a book called Man's Search for Meaning. Man's Search for Meaning. It was written by a psychiatrist called Viktor Frankl. F-R-A-N-K-L, Frankl. Viktor Frankl was a psychiatrist and a Jew when the Second World War broke out. As you know, Hitler hated Jews, so he locked up all of them and put them in what was known as concentration camps. These concentration camps were pathetic and horrible and very cruel places. They treated the inmates and the prisoners worse than we would ever dream of treating animals. Now, did Viktor Frankl have independence? No. In nothing he had independence. When the siren goes in the morning, within the next 60 seconds, they have to jump out of bed and stand at attendance, stand at attention for the attendance. Within X minutes, they have to change, get ready, etc. Within 5 minutes, they have to finish whatever pathetic breakfast they were given. Then they were all chained up and taken out to do road construction work or back breaking, stone breaking work or whatever it is. Whole day they would be there. No independence. They would come back in the night and again everything was dictated, and then one whistle would blow, lights would go off, and they would say, now you sleep. Can sleep come in a situation like that? Obviously no. Your whole body would be aching, you would feel miserable, and you would be lying there wondering, where is my life headed? The last shreds of hope were going away. People were dying left, right and center. Much more stronger people, soldiers, who are supposed to be very strong physically, they were dying. Viktor Frankl was a very ordinary fellow, he was a doctor. But what he did was, he gained his inner freedom. He said, the Nazis can control my body, they cannot control my mind. That is the crux of everything. Please remember that nobody controls your mind. Your mind is free if you choose to make it free. And what did Viktor Frankl do? He would lie down in that very miserable and pathetic condition, close his eyes and start visualizing what he would be doing once the war is over and he is out of this concentration camp. To the minutest detail, he would visualize. My house, I think my drawing room, I may give it a light cream colored paint. I think I'll have brown curtains. I think I'll put a rug or a carpet which has this design. I would get a sofa of this particular dimension and this particular design. I would then have a fireplace. I would have a lovely dog sitting next to me. I would be drinking a hot cup of coffee, listening to lilting music. And the more he started visualizing that, the more inner strength he got. Compared to guys who are much tougher than him, who died, this man survived the entire so many years of the concentration camp. And he came out a free man. And he wrote this book, Man's Search for Meaning. This is just one simple example I wanted to give you. That even in the worst of circumstances, you can nurture and build your inner freedom. Not only was life comparatively a little more tolerable in the concentration camp for him, but it actually kept him alive and brought him back to the new normal at that time, which was freedom from the Nazis. That is what we need to do. Compare that to the fact that so often I come across people who say, I am being oppressed, I am being ill-treated, so-and-so behaves very badly with me, so-and-so does not give me the independence to do what I want to do, so-and-so tries to control my life in so many different ways. Then I say, okay, what do you plan to do about it? Yeah, I'm trying my level best, but that person just doesn't want to give me that independence. That person is controlling me. That person is very strict with me. Fine. Again, I ask the same question. What do you plan to do about it? And the person says, I am helpless. What is this thing called helpless? It is a surrender. See, as you know, if you read history, there were so many wars taking place. There were wars where even a minor or a small number of soldiers with all their courage managed to beat a bigger army. There were times when huge armies surrendered and gave up, saying that, sorry, we can't fight this. So when you surrender, you obviously have no freedom left. The moment you start using this word helpless, I come across very often, and that's why I'm sharing with you. Please remember that it can happen to you or me at any time where we say that I am not being given the independence to do whatever I want, so and so is being very strict, very oppressive, very cruel to me, and I am helpless against such a person. Sorry, I refuse to believe it. There could not have been a person more helpless than Viktor Frankl, but he did not surrender. The same thing applies to you. If you are having difficulties in office, at home, in relationships, or wherever it is. So how do we move forward? How do we develop this emotional freedom, inner freedom, which I bring it out from inside and I use that freedom to do whatever I want? The first step is congruence. I would even put it as emotional honesty. Normally, honesty is an interpersonal skill. People ask, is Ali an honest guy? Does he tell the truth? Does he refrain from cheating somebody when he promises to give some money or do some work? Does he do it? Yeah, then he's an honest guy, you would say. But I want to extend that. There's a thing called emotional honesty. Am I true to my own emotions? Forget about anybody else. Am I congruent to my emotions? Even a simple thing like I told you, becoming helpless. Helplessness is an emotion. Your thoughts led to that emotion. When your thoughts said, can I fight this person? No. Can I run away from this person? No. Can I avoid this person? No. Can I think of any other option or alternative by which I can get across from this person? No. So finally, I am led to an emotion called helplessness. And the moment I start feeling helpless, I do not make any efforts towards my own freedom. I surrender. Compared to that, if I can say, yes, things are pretty bad. Much, much worse than what I had thought I would ever have to face. But still, as long as there is life, there is hope. And when there is hope, I am not helpless. I will continue non-stop to explore ways and means to find out how I can make matters better. Here again comes a very important thing, when people talk about freedom, they set certain, benchmarks, which are all or nothing type of benchmarks. Even if you see the independence struggle of India, which we are celebrating today, 73 years we've completed, go back into history and see. The Indians, our leaders, initially said, give us a little more freedom than what you are giving us. Allow us to do this and that. The British actually conducted elections for assemblies in states, and our Indian leaders and politicians contested those elections and they formed assemblies. Those assemblies could be in one moment overruled by the Viceroy and the British authorities. They really had no power in the sense of that word. But they agreed to do that. If they had stuck to the point saying that, no, you just pack up and run away from here, I don't think it would have worked. They started with that. They started slowly building up small, small areas of freedom. Till on 15th August, we got independence. When we got independence, we agreed to be part of the Commonwealth. We acknowledged the King or the Queen of England as our father figure or mother figure. We allowed the Viceroy, Lord Mountbatten, to continue to be the Viceroy of India. Why? Because we were headed in the right direction and we did not want to take drastic steps. And that is what you need to do. When you feel helpless, you have to tell yourself, okay, even if I am helpless in throwing the British out and gaining full independence, can I at least set up assemblies? Can I ask for the freedom to have political meetings and elect our leaders? Can I ask for some changes in the rules which gives us a little more flexibility to lead our lives the way we want to lead our lives. If you do not set unrealistic black and white type of benchmark, saying all or nothing type of thing. So there are people who think that way, very unfortunately. A child who is angry with his parents says, I don't want to live with my parents, I just want to get out from here, all or nothing. A person very, very, very upset with the spouse says, I want divorce and nothing else. A person who is very unhappy with his boss says, I just want to quit this job, nothing else. Now that does not get you inner freedom. Inner freedom lies in saying that I have this horrible boss. I will work towards moving away from him at the earliest opportunity. But today I will exercise my inner freedom by working in this environment and with this boss to make things as good as possible and to move towards a better life. Within a married couple, there may be certain responsibilities, there may be certain reasons where you say that, no, I do not want separation and divorce, but can I make my life a little better than what it is today? Today I am very unhappy with the way my relationship is going. But even if I can improve it 10% to start with, set those type of goals. And you know, one of the things that prevents us from these goals is what we refer to as our core negative beliefs. My boss will never allow me to do that. My spouse will never change. My so-and-so will never be this. I will never be able to have enough money to have a house of my own. We get drowned in our own core beliefs, which may have been right a few years or a few months back, but we hang on to them. It is like the story of that elephant you must have heard. There was a baby elephant which was caught by a man in the circus, brought. And in the night he wanted to make sure that the baby elephant doesn't walk off. So he would tie a rope on his neck and tie it to a pole. It was not a very thick rope, but the baby elephant was not very strong. He pulled. He didn't want to be stuck there tied to the pole. So every night he would make his efforts, pull, but it would only hurt his neck more and more. Till one fine day, the baby elephant gave up. Right? Years went past, the baby elephant grew into a huge elephant. And one day a visitor was there and he was watching the owner tying up that huge elephant with a thin rope. He said, hey man, this elephant is so big and so strong, one jerk and he can break that rope and he can walk off. How come you are tying him with that small rope? The owner says, you know that he can break it. I know that he can break it. The elephant does not know that he can break it. He's still living with his old core beliefs that I tried so much and it only kept hurting my neck, so let me not try. This is what prevents us from moving towards our own inner freedom. A simple thing like people who tell lies. You know that proverb which says you tell one lie and you have to tell 100 lies to cover that up. So have you got that inner freedom to say, I will not tell lies. I will face the consequence, doesn't matter what happens. Why should I make myself into a criminal by telling a lie and then the other person gets that self-righteous thing of saying, see, you told a lie, so I have a right now to oppress you and stuff like that. It's pretty pathetic, no? When you want to do something, you should first convince yourself that I have the freedom, and if I don't have it for some reason, I will build upon that freedom. Freedom to choose how to be happy. Freedom to choose that I don't mind being sad for some time or upset or whatever it is fine, I'm accepting it as is where is. Freedom to choose my friends. Freedom to choose my guru. Freedom to choose my beliefs. Freedom to change my beliefs. Freedom to be wrong and to admit that I was wrong and now I am going to try my life out in a different way. If these are the type of things that you are willing to do, over a period of time, you will notice that you develop tremendous freedom. You may not be able to change the oppressor or the person who is not giving you independence. Freedom is not directly connected to independence. Freedom comes from within. So let the oppressor do or say whatever he or she wants. The oppressor can only control some of your actions. The oppressor cannot control your mind. So with that, if I think I have filled your mind with a lot of stuff, a lot of food for thought, I think it's time to take a quick break. Not to advertise something or to bring in some jingles or something, but to request Seema to have a quick chat with you on some of the issues which I feel can be helpful to you, and then we'll continue. And please, by the time, ask questions, send in your questions, and we would like to respond to as many of them as possible within the allotted time. Back to Seema.
Hi again. So we would love to see questions from you. So I will just scroll all the questions down. So please keep writing. In the meantime, I thought I'll just share what Banjara has been doing in the last couple of months or last 3 months since the time the lockdown has happened. So there are a lot of new things, you know, which we are also doing for the first time. First of all, we are trying to get tech savvy, or use technology to reach out. Actually, we've always believed in that personal touch. We've always believed in face-to-face interactions, one-on-one sessions. So, but what has changed in the last 3 months, and of course, we all, have to adapt to the changes. So what we've been doing is we are getting, we're doing a lot of webinars on various platforms for a large number of organizations. I think on an average in a day, definitely we have one webinar with one of the prestigious organizations or, an NGO. At least one, if not two or more. So there are times when we are packed. We also have three webinars where, and everything obviously related to mental health. So just imagine, what is emotionally troubling so many employees, so many, working professionals who've seen this kind of a situation for the first time probably in their life. And right from children to the elderly are going through various mental challenges, and that is something that we are trying. Team Banjara and Ali is trying to get in touch with people to try to make them understand certain aspects of human behavior. So that is one. The second thing we are doing is, as you know, we are a counseling house, a training center. We have a large number of counselors who are trained here. So what many of our counselors now are doing is they are reaching out, for counseling. Many patients who are probably going through stress during these COVID times, and also doing a lot of counseling for COVID patients who are recovering. So that is another thing that Team Banjara and the counselors are doing here. And the other thing that I would like to say is we also, BBMP has approached us to conduct sessions for their employees who are dealing with the COVID patients. So we are having sessions on effective communication with these employees from BBMP who are, or volunteers from BBMP. So we are conducting training sessions for them here in our center. Another thing that we are doing in the last, of course, we've always been, there are a lot of courses which go on. So there are online courses and of course our classroom sessions. I would request you all to go to our website, and we have also worked on our website in the last couple of months. And you can go there and get all the information related to these courses to, become a counselor yourself. And of course, our team of counselors as usual, through telephone, through face-to-face counseling. There's, and as you know, Banjara Academy provides free counseling. So we are counseling through emails, through phone calls, and of course, face-to-face counseling also. So these are some of the things I thought I'll update you. So now back to Ali, and please write in your questions and Ali will address the same. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Seema, and here I am back again. Satyan has asked a very nice question. Is free will the same? Yes, more or less. It's a little bit of play of words. You know, the English language is such a wonderful language that you have these synonyms, things which mean very closely to each other. So you have this choice of words. You can say free will, you can say inner freedom, you can even use the word independent. There's nothing wrong with it. But what I am stressing on is the fact that we need to build that ability from within to say, I am not helpless. I am facing difficulties. You know what they say, that, you know, it is difficult, but it is not impossible, as long as you take that. The moment you say something is impossible, you have surrendered. Okay, I want to request to add English subtitles when you upload on YouTube. The reason is deaf people will be able to get this precious knowledge. Right, very good suggestion. We'll work on that and we'll ask our technical team. I'm a technology zero, so I'll request our technical team, particularly our Meera and Sunita, who do a lot of work behind the scenes. I'm sure they will be able to come out with something. Naveena says, very well pointed out, that we can choose to strengthen our inner freedom, however bad may be the situation. Remarkable example of Viktor Frankl. Also got to the beautiful difference between independence. Very well pointed out. Yeah. Next. What is the next comment or question?
Can you please, so Kumara is, Kumara Swami is asking, can you please suggest a few symptoms or behaviors through which an individual understands that he has achieved the desired freedom?
Yes, as I told you, one is this thing, if you use words like helpless, you know that you are not free. No, I can't do anything about it. I'm helpless, you know, so and so is so strict, so and so is so cruel, so and so is so dominating that I am, you know, helpless about it. So the day you stop using the word helpless, you know that you have taken the first step. The second is, when you have choices, when you ask yourself, do I have choices? I can do option A, option B. No, option A may have too much of consequences, or it may hurt somebody, or I may fail doing it. So I'll keep it aside for the time being, but I'll move on to option B. The moment your mind tells you that there is more than one alternative, you are headed towards that inner freedom. Satyan is asking, what is wrong in surrendering? Of course, in a positive way, doesn't that strengthen an individual? You see, in war, for example, surrender is when you give up the war. But tactical withdrawal is when you give up the battle and prepare for the longer war. So there are wise generals who at times say, no, there's no point in fighting this battle right now because we are going to lose. So we make a tactical withdrawal. There's a difference between withdrawal and surrender. Once I surrender, it's over. I can't get back. But if I withdraw, I can prepare myself, strengthen myself, and come back for a better battle next time, so that the long-term goal, that is the war. Nowadays, everybody is using war. What Seema was telling you just now about the BBMP people whom we were training yesterday also, we had a long session with them. They are the people working in the war room. So there is a bigger war that is taking place. But the battles are changed, as you can see, even during this lockdown and this and that. Government has been trying out various things. Government says, okay, total lockdown. Then they say, no, maybe that's destroying the economy and stuff like that. So we'll have a Sunday lockdown, or we'll have a night curfew or something of that sort. Now, these are the times when you are not exactly surrendering, but you are withdrawing to rethink and come out with different alternatives and options. But you are not surrendering yourself to the pandemic. You are saying that we are fighting and we will win the war with the pandemic that has hit us. How do we break free from restrictions laid down by loved ones which are for our own good? Yes, a lot of people do that, you know. It's amazing where they say that it's for our own good. Okay, if that person is a little reasonable, at least open to dialogue without shooting off his mouth and getting very irritated and angry, if you can make that person define what is my own good. I tell this to children also. If the father says, no, you have to be a software engineer, you have to be a doctor or something, I tell them, instead of fighting with your parent, ask them, Dad, Mom, why do you feel that I'll make a good doctor or that software engineering is the right career for me? Can you explain? It'll be easier for me, no? If I'm convinced by you, then I think I'll be a little more motivated to take that thing up. So you start with that. Now, if the person says, no, I have said it and that's why it is, no argument, the person is very, very strict, then you look for little loopholes in between that. If I have to do this, can I have something else? So I am again looking for those little battles which I can win. In the major thing, okay, you're not giving me the independence to do what I want. Can I get independence in some minor thing so that I can continue with this? While I'm doing software engineering, can I also enroll for an art class and pursue my dream of becoming an artist or a designer or something of that sort? Can we take help from subconscious mind to improve emotional health? Yes, subconscious mind in fact is the one that governs you. When I was talking about these core beliefs and all that, they are all embedded into our subconscious mind. No, my father will never agree. No, my boss will never consider what I am saying. No, my relationship with X will never improve. That is what has been embedded in your subconscious mind. For example, we teach people, I'm right now also doing a course on CBT, cognitive behavior therapy. So what we do is we reprogram the subconscious mind to get away these negative core beliefs, change the cognitive distortions and start thinking on the positive side. Now, Anushree says, isn't it natural for this lady to feel helpless? Ah, no, it is not natural. The way human beings have been made by creation, we have been made into fighters. Even a small baby does not feel helpless. The baby screams, shouts, tries to grab things from his mother, tries to push. The day the baby feels, I am so tiny and so helpless, if my mother doesn't feed me, I am going to starve. That's the end of the, you know, life of that baby before it began. But where did this come from? It is a natural instinct for survival. When you say you are helpless, you are programming your mind to surrender. Don't ever do that. As long as there is life, there is hope. Even if the other person doesn't change, I can change to some extent and bring about a change in my own life. And classic example of that was Viktor Frankl. Prasad says, in decision making, if the suppressed person is doing the right decision and the controlling person does not agree with the decision, how do you handle it? That's exactly what I was telling you a minute back. That sometimes you need to look for via media. What you are asking, Prasad, is, you know, plus or minus. You take one decision, so the suppressing person takes a decision. There are always via medias to everything in life. That's the beauty of life. That's the beauty of relationships. It is not just black or white, or, you know, it's not binary like the computer that it has to be, you know, yes or no or some one or zero or something of that sort. Life has so many varieties to offer. Bargain, okay, you're not giving me the independence to do this, but can you please allow me to do that? Can you please not interfere if I do this? Can I add on something different and do it for myself? Every time that you need to take a tactical step back, negotiate, try and get something done, be patient, look for different options and alternatives. You will find that something or the other turns up over a period of time. Yeah. Let me also tell you one important thing. If you really want to gain that enough freedom, bring about change when there is no crisis. Some of us make a fundamental mistake. We become very complacent when things are going fine and not feeling helpless. I have no interpersonal issues or battles to be won or anything of that sort. So I become complacent. I think this is how life is going to be. And I get confident that this is how it is going to be. It's like the person who is earning well and he takes a lot of loans and builds up huge EMIs and this and that and says that, yeah, if I'm earning 1 rupee and if I have to pay EMIs of 70 paisa, so what's wrong with it? He has not prepared himself for the worst, right? So what I always recommend is, whenever you feel that there is a need for change, wherever you feel that complacency has set in, bring about the change when things are going fine. Have that courage and that build your inner freedom to say, while I am happy with the way things are going, I am going to make them better by bringing about a change. In the long run, things will be better. Vidya says we must try to remove denial so we can accept the reality of our lives, our strengths and weaknesses. Does this hold good for every conflict? Absolutely, Vidya. I had mentioned and I am repeating again, people who are in denial are the people who suffer most. If they deny that I have got some resources, if they deny that I am not helpless, if they deny that there is a middle path, those are the people who suffer most. Please do not live in denial. Even a simple thing like, you know, health today when we are talking about COVID and all that. Who are the people who are really suffering? Those who are in denial. I've had two or three cases of people who are very obviously showing symptoms of COVID, but they refuse to go to a doctor or to get themselves tested. And finally, when things hit them badly, they lost their lives. These are the only cases of death that I've come across from the hundreds and hundreds that we are dealing with. The moment somebody said that, yes, there is a possibility that I may be COVID positive because I'm experiencing these symptoms or because I've been in contact with somebody who is COVID positive, when they went for treatment, within days they came out happy, rejuvenated and free from all the anxieties and worries. Ah, Varnika has asked a very nice question. Does self-esteem play a role in surrendering? Yes, Varnika, you're absolutely right. That helplessness that I was talking about, the surrendering and giving up on things, that happens very often. I'm not saying always, but it does happen, or it gets contributed to if you have a low self-esteem. If you consider yourself not worthy enough, not capable enough, then you do not even make the efforts that are required to overcome whatever battle you are facing. Ha, Reena says, blessed Independence Day to all and family. May we value our freedom and use it to bless others. Wonderful thought, Reena. That's exactly what I have been saying, more so during the last few weeks and months. This is the time to reach out to others. This is the time to tell everybody that we are not helpless against this pandemic. We have the freedom to do what we want. This is another case where some of the people are just surrendering to the pandemic. They feel that the moment they step out of the house, you know, that monster is sitting outside to grab them and kill them or something of that sort. I don't want to go into statistics. I don't want to, you know, argue with people who want to take precautions. Yes, I respect them. But this extremity to which, if by chance you are, or somebody known to you is taking, then I would like you to please give a second thought to it. However bad the pandemic, however bad lockdowns or financial economic hassles and all that are there, there are ways and means, there are alternatives to come out of the thing. Can you tell us a bit more on emotional freedom? We tend to react uncontrollably. Anika, you'll use the right word, react. Anything that you react to can have negative consequences. If you respond to something, take a simple thing which we all know, but very few of us practice. I tell people, if you suddenly find yourself angry, irritated, helpless, feeling totally lost, the simplest thing to do is to count to 10. What do you mean count to 10? All it means is take 10 seconds before you react and then you will be responding. If you say something or do something at that moment when it has hit you, you will be reacting. It will be impulsive. If you take that 10 seconds, you will be responding. That's for a situation where you have to immediately, you know, give back to something that is happening right in front of you. If you are facing a more serious issue or a more serious problem or a more serious operation, there's another proverb which says, sleep over it. 24 hours and your thinking is so much more rational, you won't believe it. Your mind goes through that entire cycle of being awake and being asleep. Your subconscious mind takes over, unconscious mind takes over when you are asleep, and when you wake up the next day, you are in a far better position to take some decisions and to make better things. Sri Rajeshwari says, if one of the couple is having personality disorder like narcissism, how can the other one maintain emotional freedom? You still can, Sri Rajeshwari. The person has a disorder. He's a very, very unreasonable person. He is narcissistic. He wants to impose his cruelty on others. But he can do it only on your body, no? He can only restrict you physically. He cannot restrict you mentally. And in fact, I would say, if you have identified that this person has a personality disorder or is suffering from a mental disorder, whatever it may be, then perhaps you can be a little more kind to him. You can say that he is not doing it because he hurt me. It is like, you know, some of the alcoholics, when they are under the influence of alcohol, they use bad words, they fight with people and all that. But a person who knows him well says, it is not this man talking, it is his alcohol that is talking. So I know that tomorrow morning he will be a good guy. So let me just keep away from him right now. The same thing happens over here. It is his disorder that is making him become so oppressive. Now within that, what can I do and what I cannot do? What I can do on short-term basis, what can I do on long-term basis? How much can I negotiate with him that, okay, you are so narcissistic, you don't want me to do something, something. I am willing to oblige you and go by your thing. Can I at least have something else? So when you ask for something very small, the person has a tendency to agree to the thing. Surekha says, how is emotional freedom exercised when we face a conflict between right versus right? Now this thing of right and wrong, according to me, is a very, very hazy area. I remember there was a debate once among people who were trying to tell others that you should be vegetarian because you should not kill animals and eat them. So they had prepared a lot of ground and there was this very nice and very productive debate that was going on. And this person was very emotional and he was trying to get the message across saying that it's a living being, yeah. The animal also has emotions, the animal has aspirations, the animal has relationships. How can you cut out all that and kill that animal just to appease your hunger when you know that you can also eat vegetarian food? There was this very interesting character sitting over there. He just got up and looked at that gentleman and said, excuse me, is that a silk shirt that you are wearing? One silk shirt kills hundreds of caterpillars, that silkworms. How can you kill hundreds of silkworms just to make a shirt for yourself when you can wear a cotton or a polyester shirt? That is what I meant by saying, let us not become so moralistic as to talk about right and this and that. In fact, I even ask people who are, you know, suffering from bad relationships, is it more important for you to be right? Or is it more important for you to be happy? Choose. You'll know what the answer is. Some of these things, you know, we need to work on it on a long-term basis. Since we still have a couple of minutes, I wanted to bring in one important point before we take the last questions. Please allow more and more freedom to children to question your actions. Whenever you're dealing with children, encourage your children to question your discipline, your authority, your rules and regulations. You'll be doing a great favor. Where you feel that there is a thing, you say that no, you cannot go to school because of this pandemic, or you cannot do this, or I will not allow you to do that, fine.